Good morning, everyone. Welcome to church. Would you stand to your feet? Put your hands together as we worship Jesus today. Come on, sing this out. Sing, I give you glory.
I give you glory for all you brought me through. And now I'm ready for whatever you want to do. I'm moving forward to follow after you. And now I'm ready for whatever you want to do.
Sing it out.
Your presence is an open door. We want you, Lord, like never before. Your presence is an open door. So come now, Lord, like never before.
Sing it every season.
Every season, your grace has been enough, and I'm believing that the best is yet to come.
Sing the cross before,
the cross before me, and my hope on things above, and in you, Jesus, the best.
Keep those hands going. God, we invite your presence in this place. Come on, lift this up.
God, we're so glad you're here. And if you're here in this room right now, then you've made it through the construction zone. And so thank you. You can give yourself a hand for that. We're so glad that you're here. Thanks for bearing with us over the next couple of weeks here as they finish up construction. It's actually going to serve us and help us get in and out smoother. So thank you for making church a priority this morning. We're so glad that you're here in this room. And if you're watching online, we're so glad you're here with us as well. I believe with all my heart that there's a purpose and a reason that you're watching church today, that you're here with us this morning. I believe God wants to speak something to you directly to your heart, maybe directly to a situation that you're walking through, and he wants to equip you to walk with him and to win in life. And so we have an awesome message here coming up. And before we hear that, we want to dive into a time of worship this morning. and ask God to do what only He can do. So let's pray this morning as we start. Jesus, we just fix our eyes and all of our attention on You. We thank You that there's no one higher and no one greater than You, Jesus. Would You just right now, in Jesus' name, calm the other voices that may be vying for our attention right now. Just calm all the distractions, Lord, and let us focus in on You and hear from You and meet with You this morning, Jesus. You're the miracle-working God. You're the one who makes a way where there seems to be no way. That is who You are, and that's the God that we worship and lift up in our hearts with our voices this morning. We love You, Lord. Be here to me. God is the way maker, the miracle working God. Thank you, Jesus. We thank you this morning that even when we don't see it, you're working, you're moving in our lives this morning. We can sing this out in faith. Come on.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working.
Come on.
You never stop. Yes.
Faith is the substance of the things that we hope for and the evidence of the things unseen, the things we can't see. But what if we're in a situation where the things that we hope for and what we see don't line up? What do we do in that moment? I believe this morning we have an opportunity to put trust in the gap of what we can see and what we hope for if they don't line up. Because we can put our trust in a God who's never failed us. He's faithful. He's faithful. And I just want to encourage you. The song God of the Breakthrough, when I wrote that song, it was in a season where what I hoped for and what I could see with my physical eyes did not align. And it was an opportunity for me to put trust in the gap and go back to God, you are who you say you are. That's why that chorus says, I believe you are who you say you are. That wasn't just words, you know, fancy on a page. That was like the heart cry. It's God, I believe in the middle of the mess, I believe that you are who you say you are and that you're able to do what you said you'll do. That's who he is. So this morning, I just felt led to just create a moment together where we just still our hearts and we put trust in the gap. Are there things that you're hoping for that you don't see? Situations that seem beyond your control or beyond what you can do, then right now, God's here. He wants to just encourage you this morning as we bring those things before him. So we're going to sing this hymn together. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him. Let's sing it out.
Jesus, Jesus, trust him. How I've proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus. Oh, for grace to trust him more. We put our trust in trust you, how
Nothing is impossible. 3:19, Jesus said, with man, this is impossible, but with God, all things are possible. I want to remind you are with God this morning. He is with you in your challenges and things you're facing. I was talking to a gentleman before service. He said this week is one of the toughest weeks of his life. He needs breakthrough. Well, we serve a God of the breakthrough, and he's with us. And I believe today for you and what you're facing, even as we worship God, there's breakthrough happening. And today in this service and this message is exactly what you need to hear. So do you receive that today? Let's give God thanks for breaking through. Well, good morning. Welcome to the 9:15 service. So glad to have you guys with us. As Pastor Blake said, thank you for finding your way through some of those closed roads and getting yourself in here. We'll probably have people coming in late with the traffic, so just make way for them as they come in. If you're a guest, we got to meet some of you today here for the first time. Welcome. At Milestone, we count you as an honored guest. When you're a guest here, like, it's our favorite thing. And so there's people sitting beside you that would love to meet you and just get to know you. But there's a simple way for you to let us know you're here, and we can send information to you we think is helpful, and also a gift we prepared that we think you'll be excited to receive when you get it. And so in your seat back, you'll see it when you sit down in a moment, but it's a communication card. Just fill it out with your basic info, and we'll mail you that info this week. We don't show up at your house, we don't bother you with phone calls, but just let us know how we can serve you. We'd love to serve you as best that we can. Milestone family, there's also the place for prayer needs. This week, our team is going to be praying for you, crying over your requests. It's just awesome to see when the staff gathers to pray for you. And so let us know how we can pray for you. If you are new here and you've never taken the first step at Milestone Church, Discovery 101 is next week. Pastor Jeff, I would love to share the vision with you, meet you. So that is next week. There's more details in your service guide for that. Well, today, we're continuing the Live Well series, and we have returning to us a man that you guys love. He speaks to us annually here at Milestone Church, one of our overseers, Pastor Steve Robinson. Will you warmly greet him? Applause. Thank you, Pastor Steve. Some of you don't know Pastor Steve, but he has been with us since the very, very beginning. As Pastor Jeff says, he's probably one of the most significant voices speaking into the life, the direction, and Milestone, what God has done through Milestone Church. And he's one of Pastor Jeff's best friends, closest friends. And he pastors at Church of the King. It's a multi-site church in the Gulf Coast region. They have campuses from Biloxi to Baton Rouge, a big presence in New Orleans, in the greater New Orleans area. And today he is continuing the Live Well series and has a real special message for us. And when he comes, I believe God really gives him something to deposit into us, to share with us. And so I hope you receive this today. It's going to be a great message. Before he comes, will you turn around, find someone you don't know, tell them you're glad to see him today at Milestone.
Man, it is so exciting to be with you guys here at Milestone Church. I also want to welcome those that are joining us online. How many of y'all excited to be in church? Come on, Sunday morning, early crowd. Excited to be here. We love coming to Milestone Church. I want to thank Pastor Steve for that warm introduction. And it's wonderful. We've been journeying with your pastor, Pastor Jeff, for 20 years. He and Brandy, Jennifer, and I. And we love Pastor Jeff. And I often say this, he's not only the smartest pastor I know, but the funniest. And we just love hanging out, talking a lot. And I want to just say how proud I am of you guys as a church. And we had the board meeting yesterday, and I know some of our great, see Mr. Ed, one of the great board men here at the church. And it's exciting. It is so exciting to hear all that God is doing at Milestone Church. I want to thank you as well for those of you that have been giving to the Beyond campaign. How many of y'all excited that God is blessing this church so much that it needs to expand? Come on. How many of y'all excited about that? Man, it is awesome. So we want to just say again, we are thrilled to be here. And Pastor Jeff has been in a series. And I watched it this week as I was preparing my message. I thought, you know, I wanted to be able to see where you guys are. And it's how to live well. And it's interesting, some of the topics, again, some of the very practical topics that the Bible addresses. And how to overcome stress. Again, all of us deal with stress. How to walk through transition and some of the relational issues and tensions that we all deal with. And I just thought it'd be appropriate in this message that one of the things that we often don't think about in this whole context of living well. And I'm not going to ask for a show of hands. I know every single one of you want to live well. You want to have a life that honors God, but you also want to make a difference with your life and make an impact. And by the way, you want to finish well. See, part of finishing well is living well. That you don't cross the finish line all just beat up and bruised, but you actually go into eternity and you receive that God gave Paul. He says, there's a crown stored up for you. See, I want to live well so that I can finish well. But one of the things that we often don't consider in this whole context of living in the here and now is that we don't live in just one realm. I want everybody to tune in what I'm about to say. We don't live in just one realm. We have one foot solidly planted in what I call a natural realm, an earthly realm. Bible talks about it. We got up this morning and either came to church or those of you, again, if it was Monday, going to work, most of the majority of people would be going to work unless you're retired, and the kids would be going to school. So there's the waking up, there's the getting out of bed, there's all the different dynamics related to the natural realm. And we become proficient at that. We become well apt to our environments, and we learn how to do that better and better. By the way, the Bible actually talks about the practical dimensions of living well in the natural realm. But one of the areas that I think that we often, what I would say that we don't appropriately consider is that we don't just live in one realm. While our feet are solidly planted in this natural realm, the Bible says, by the way, the Bible says that we are also solidly planted in a spiritual realm. There's a spiritual realm that surrounds us. It doesn't matter if somebody's an atheist, somebody doesn't believe in God, if they're an agnostic, they're not sure, if they're a Christian that's not aware, or if they're an on-fire Christian. It doesn't matter who you are. Every single one of us are daily living, listen, impacted by the natural realm, but also by a spiritual realm. I want to talk to you today about how to live well in the spiritual realm. That there is a cosmic, listen, there is a spiritual dynamic that's happening, and actually, there is also a warfare attached to that. I remember when I got saved 30 years ago, there was a lot of teaching on spiritual warfare, and I loved it, and I thought it was so healthy as a young believer that, yes, we love Christ, and we trust Christ, and what he did on the cross, but there's also, listen, in Greek plays, there's an antagonist, and there's a protagonist. A protagonist is the word pro is for. There is somebody for you. How many are grateful that God is for you? We believe the Bible teaches that. God is for you. Who can be against you? But there's an antagonist. And the antagonist, the Bible talks about, is Satan himself, the adversary. So we are in this battle in the here and now. I know that it's often not spoken about, it, that present day church world, again, pastor teaches about it, Pastor Jeff does a great job, but there is a real devil. And we are in a warfare with the devil. Matter of fact, it's funny, I heard this story once about this mom, and she had this real radical little kid, and she's just an excited little boy and hyperactive, and of course, I can relate to that, and I was born in Des Moines, Iowa, grew up in New Orleans, but I was so hyperactive as a kid. I mean, they did things in the game. They did things to me in school that people would go to jail for today. Stick the kid under the desk. We can't control him. How many of y'all remember getting stuck under the desk? Don't raise your hand. But anyway, today, there's a lawsuit. I'm like, put the kid in the closet. I got it. He can't shut up. But anyway, so I was kind of like this kid, but this mom was dealing with their hyperactive son, and man, he's just so hyperactive. She said, listen, you can't wander off and play in other people's yards all day long. You can't do that. You got to stay in our yard. And she goes, well, mama, I'm playing in our yard, and the devil gets behind, and the devil just whispers to me, and he tempts me, mama. And so I just get tempted, and I just fall for it. She said, well, listen, when Satan comes to tempt you, here's what you need to say. You need to say, get behind me what? Come on, say it. Satan. You need to say, get behind me, Satan. Well, the little boy was just so excited, just couldn't stop. And so the mom says, I'm gonna kind of help out in the natural realm. I'm gonna actually put a fence around our house. So she put a fence around the house. One Sunday afternoon, she's looking over there, and the little boy had cut a hole through the fence, and he's also in the neighbor's yard again. She said, Johnny, come back in here. What did I tell you? Listen, what did I tell you to say when you're tempted by the devil to go into your neighbor's yard? Well, mama, you told me that to say to the devil, get behind me, Satan. And I did that. Well, then what happened? Well, he pushed me right through the hole of the fence. Now, that's funny, but how many of you know that our lives are being pushed around by the enemy sometimes and God doesn't want it? We're allowing the enemy to come into our lives and just kind of go free course. We just kind of come in there, put bitterness in our heart, put resentment in our heart, put judgment in our heart, torment our lives, let spirits of lust, all this stuff just get us all. How many of you know that we can really, according to Scripture, say, get behind me, Satan, and the devil really does need to obey? The Bible says that we are in a warfare. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, I want to read a scripture that I'll base this message on today. 2 Corinthians, Paul's writing to the church at Corinth, and here's what he says. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, he says, for though we live in the world, natural world, everyone say natural world. We're not denying that at all. We live in a natural world. He says, but we do not wage war as the world does. He says, for the Christian, we live in the world, a natural world and a spiritual world, but we do not wage war as the world does. The weapons, whoa, what's he talking about? The weapons. I thought Christianity was about loving Jesus. It is, but you're in a warfare. There's a battle. The weapons that we fight with, wait, time out. I thought we came to Christ. It's like, man, we come to Jesus. We trust Jesus for our salvation. Our name is written down in the Lamb's Book of Life. We're eternally secure with God. And now you're talking about, Paul, you're talking about weapons and warfare and fighting. Well, he says the weapons that we fight with, they're not the weapons of the world. So as believers, Paul begins to demonstrate for us scripturally, he begins to say, listen, guys, to the church at Corinth, you guys are in a warfare. And you can't, listen, you can't press exit button. You can't get out of here. You can't just say, well, I don't want to be involved in that. No. We're in it, whether we like it or not. The issue is, do we understand it? Are we equipped and are we winning? Paul says we are in a battle. I love the Apostle Paul. I'm actually teaching through the book of Philippians right now, and it's a fantastic book, 4 chapters, one of the most practical books in the New Testament. I love it. Paul wrote the book of Philippians in prison. Matter of fact, there's a number of books that he wrote, letters actually, to different churches while he was in prison. The book of Ephesians is one of those books that he was in prison writing back to the church in Ephesus, and here's what he talks about. I'm outlining for you guys, and I'm highlighting, listen, Christianity is we love God, we're forgiven of our sins, we have a relationship with Jesus, and listen, and we're going to heaven and not the alternative, which is not a good thing. But even though we're not going to hell, how many know God doesn't want you to live in hell on the earth while you're here? That we can, listen, we can live victorious. Doesn't mean that we're exempt from trials. Doesn't mean we're exempt from pain. Doesn't mean we're exempt from tribulation. But we do not have to succumb to the strategies of the enemy. Paul said it this way in Ephesians chapter 6. I'm outlining and building a case. Ephesians chapter 6, it says, finally, my brother, be strong in the Lord. Our strength doesn't come from our own personality. It's funny, my daughter, she just graduated from college, and so she came home one day. She goes, Dad, she goes, listen, you are an 8 on the Enneagram. I'm a what? Well, you're an 8. I said, well, tell me what that means. She goes, well, you have to sit right down. So she started just explaining basically who I am. It doesn't matter what God says, but what does the Enneagram say? You ever have somebody kind of come and evaluate you, you know, based on that, you know, on the Myers-Briggs, you know, on the DISC analysis, on that. Y'all remember when you used to, like, go to God? She goes, well, you're an 8 on the Enneagram. That means that you respond to me this way. And can I get a sheet to tell me how to respond to you? I'd like to know that. Paul says, listen, your strength against the enemy doesn't come because you're a type A. It doesn't because you're a D personality. Your strength, listen, the strength of your personality is inconsequential related to spiritual warfare. Has nothing to do with it. Matter of fact, the enemy can reduce down. Listen, that has nothing to do with it. He says, finally, my brethren, you're not strong because you're an 8 on the Enneagram. You're strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on. So there's a proactive nature to spiritual warfare. Put on. Wow, Pastor, there's a fight. There's a warfare. There's an adversary. And now now Paul's telling me I got to put on something. I received Jesus. Yeah, but you got to put on something. Well, I got to put on the armor of God that I may be able to stand against the wiles. Now, I want to pause right there. The word wiles in the Greek, it's translated in English actually better, strategy. Strategy. I believe that God has a plan for our lives. Matter of fact, I'm not going to ask for a show of hands. Every single one of us, as Christ followers, we'd raise our hand. We believe that God has a plan for our lives. We believe that. But let me just say this respectfully. The enemy also has a plan for your life. to wound you, to harm you, to abuse you, and to keep you, listen, to keep you uneducated scripturally about how to fight against him. The Bible says very clearly there's a strategy. The enemy has a strategy. Doesn't it blow your mind that you guys, listen, that all of us sometimes keep going through the exact same temptation? Isn't it interesting the very thing that we go to work and we think that we finally have gotten rid of that person, whoever that person is, that would torment us until we get to the next place and that exact person, it's like they transferred with us. I mean, they have a different name, different face, but it's the same personality. Are y'all with me? Isn't it interesting that that besetting sin that you're always trying to deal with, you're always trying to overcome it, it seems like it just pops up every decade in your life. Isn't there a reason? Yeah, because there's a strategy. Are y'all with me? And Paul says we are not to be ignorant. We are to be wise, spiritually speaking, of the strategies of the enemy. Satan has a strategy. We need to be aware of the strategy. It's interesting, when I became a Christian, I was a freshman at Tulane University, and my parents, some of you guys have heard my story before, my parents prayed for me for just years to get saved, you know, and my mom, I was on every prayer list in America, literally, I was. My mom would go, you know, she'd stop people in the grocery store, are you a Christian, you know, can you pray for my son, he's a heathen, I'm with her. I'm like, Mom, you shouldn't say that in front of me, but you are, you need to know that, you know. Literally, I was on everybody's prayer list. Matter of fact, I wouldn't even go into the living room because my mom, you know, Christian television, you know, she'd send $10 to some evangelist. Would you pray for my heathen son? There's a young man. He's in New Orleans. He's a heathen. Your mom just sent me money. I'm praying for you. Literally. I'm not joking. I'm literally not joking about this. So my mom would routinely tell me, you know, the people in the church would tell me. Well, finally, by the way, I tell people this. If your mom is a Christian, spirit-filled, born again, loves Christ, and you're not saved, listen, and she's praying for you, just give up. You can't even enjoy your sin. Come on, how many of you know what I'm talking about? If you got a praying mom or a grandma, put her in that slot. Either one. Either one. Finally, I get saved. I'm 19 years old. I'm a freshman in college. I get born again at a college Bible study. What's crazy is, now I'm partying in the French Quarter, acting like just nuts, all right, serving the devil. And by the way, you can serve the devil and not worship the devil. Are you with me? People that don't know Christ are not worshiping Jesus. Are y'all with me? If you're not a Christian living for yourself, you're not living for God. You're living for another one. And so I'm in the French Quarter. I'm just living crazy. I get saved. This is nuts. I get saved about 3 months into my walk with Jesus. And all of a sudden at nighttime, one night, there's this overwhelming fear that comes on me. And I literally feel like I'm going to die. Not physiologically, like I'm going to have a heart attack, but I was so scared. I thought somebody's in the room. And I was tormented by a literal demonic spirit of fear. This is my first encounter with spiritual warfare. I was so scared. For 9 months, I slept with the lights on. Now, remember this. I'm in the French Quarter 4 months before parting. I'm now saved, and I'm in my room scared. Why is that? Because now I've become a threat to the kingdom of darkness. Before, I was on the enemy's team. Now I'm on God's team. Are y'all with me? Some of you think, well, man, why does all this happen to me? Well, you've switched jerseys. Are you with me? You took off the Cowboys. Now you're part of the Saints. I'm sorry. I shouldn't have said that. Whoa, Pastor. Is y'all spirit clean towards me this weekend? I just thought I'd just share that. Get back to the Bible. But anyway. The enemy wanted to come torment me. Now, I'm going to finish the message. I'm going to talk about how we overcame that. But there's a real battle that we're in as Christians, a real battle. Paul said, verse 13 of Ephesians 6, for we wrestle not. Listen, for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood. Watch this. Everybody look at me. You think your problem's against your spouse. Well, you think your problem's against your boss. Well, we'll just get in them. Yeah, but at some point in time, we have to realize all of these challenges, it's not, Paul says, our trouble, our challenge is not against flesh and blood. Sure, we have to have interpersonal relationship skills. Sure, we also have to have crucial conversations with people. Of course. But there's another realm that's influencing our lives. It's another realm that's manipulating culture. Manipulating society, manipulating governmental structures. Paul talks about it. He says, so there's a wrestling match that's going on, but it's not against flesh and blood. That's the problem. We got to get our eyes off of people. These are all the people. This is a person. No. There's another thing at play here. Well, our war is against principalities and powers and against the rulers of the darkness of this age. Paul says, listen, there's another battle against a spiritual host of wickedness in the heavenly place. Pastor, this is wild. I mean, this is all about serving Christ and being a Christian, the blood of Jesus. This is like this warfare that's going on. I didn't realize that. Well, you're in it. Could it be that some of the challenges that you're dealing with that you think are in the natural realm, could it be that the origination of them are not in the natural, it's actually in the spiritual realm? Because here's what I found out. You can't defeat spiritual entities with natural strategies. You need to have spiritual strategies to defeat spiritual beings. Are y'all with me? So I want to talk to you. I'm going to give you three things. I'm going to give you three concepts about spiritual warfare, and then I'm just going to briefly touch on some things I'm hoping to whet your appetite that you'll study more. Let me give you three truths about spiritual warfare. Number one, this is important. You are not alone in your battles. You have to understand that. You and I, as a Christian, we are never, ever alone. In fact, there's an interesting story in 2 Kings chapter 6. It tells the story of the nation of Israel. They're at war with the king of Ammon. And it's interesting that the prophet Elisha is in dialogue with this young man. And watch what happens. I'm talking about, listen, number one, principle number one, spiritual warfare. You're not alone in your battles. You've got to understand what's happening, all right? Watch this. 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 15. And when the servant of the man of God arose early and went out, there was an army surrounding the city with horses and chariots. And his servant said to him, "Alas," watch this, "my master, what shall we do?" And he answered, "Do not fear, for those who are with us are more than those who are with them." He's like, what are you talking about? There's a literal army, all right, that's invading the people of God. There's a literal army. Not figuratively speaking, the first concept is there's a literal thing. He sees it. But then the prophet of God, because he walks with God, gave him a perspective check. How many of you know that sometimes we need a perspective check? We get so ensconced and entrenched in our natural world, we forget that there's spiritual things that are happening around us. We forget that. It's like, I gotta go to work. We got the kids. Oh yeah, we got soccer. We forget. We forget what's going on. This is one of the first principles of spiritual warfare. And Elisha said, wait, time out. Okay, all right, let me pray a prayer. All right, just hang on. Because there are legitimately in the natural realm, the circumstances, listen, are perceived to be overwhelming perception. They're in the natural realm, it looks like we are in bad shape. But let me do a perspective check. This is a spiritual perspective check. Here it is, watch this. Verse 17, Lord, I pray, open his eyes. That's my prayer for you guys today. Open your eyes. Why? That they may see. Then the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, and he saw. What did he see? Now he's looking outside of the natural realm. This is a perspective check for all of us here. And behold, some of you are going to realize, that problem that I'm having with that person, I'm realizing there's something behind it. There's something that's going on that's manipulating our relationships because we keep going down that same trail and there's something happening. Well, there is. Lord, open the eyes of the young man. The Lord opened the eyes of the young man and he saw, and behold, the mountain was full of horses. Now, this is not in the natural. He saw a picture into the spiritual realm. And he said, behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elijah. What did the Lord do? He opened the servant's eyes and he saw God's angelic army and the spiritual forces of heaven aligned on his behalf. What if we were in a work situation, a family, a financial, whatever situation we're in, what if our eyes could be open and we realize there's more for us than against us? How would our perspective shift? We wouldn't cower and just, but there would be a holy boldness, not because of the strength and the bravado of our type A personality, but because of the reality of the unseen realm working on our behalf. Whoa, there's a lot more for us than against us. Number one, you're not alone in your battles. Number two, your prayers are far more powerful than you realize. They're far more powerful. Your prayers. Well, I prayed about it. Nothing really happened. Well, what farmer plants a seed one time and nothing happens? You plant it, then you water it, and you till it, and you in the ground, and you stay at it. Then there's a power of pay. Every time you pray, listen, every time a born-again Christian with the Holy Spirit on the inside, every one of us are Christ followers, the Spirit of God comes to live in your heart. It's the gift of the Holy Spirit. You're forgiven of your sins, the gift of the Holy Spirit. When the Spirit of God's in your heart, God hears your prayers. But there's things that are shifting. Listen, sometimes immediately you see the answer, but God heard your prayers. God heard your prayers. Matter of fact, if you look in the book of Acts, you don't have to open to it, but the church was they were gaining understanding of the power of prayer in the spiritual realm. Matter of fact, the first Christian martyr, Stephen, Acts chapter 7, you can read about it. The first Christian martyr, Stephen, actually the second Christian martyr, Acts chapter 11, his name was James. By the way, my mom called me, your name is Stephen James. That's my name. I thought, I hope that's not prophetic. But anyway, Stephen James. The third person that was potentially martyred was Peter. Church is wising up. Wait a minute. Every time our people go to jail for preaching the gospel, they get killed. Wait. Acts chapter 11, let's pray about it. Lord, I'm just praying that you would deliver Peter. God, that you would do something on his behalf. Next thing you know, an angel shows up. An angel opens the door. Peter's like, what's up? The angel's like, some of your people praying. God sent me to open that thing. Your prayers are a lot more powerful than you realize. My mom prayed for me. My grandma, people prayed for me. They're a lot more powerful. Why do we give up? The spiritual realm, listen, there's things that are shifting the moment we pray our first prayer. Well, there's an enemy. He doesn't like that. But the Bible says your prayers are more powerful than him. James chapter 5, verse 16, the effect of fervent prayer of a righteous person avails much. Well, what does the enemy want to do? Let me give you three quick strategies of the enemy. Number one, what does the enemy do? Why does he want to get you to back off from church, back off from reading the Bible, back off from prayer, back off from understanding this concept? Why? Because there's three things he does. Number one, let me give you just a little strategy. Let's expose the strategy of the enemy. I played for a great high school football team, and on Saturdays, we would watch the film of the opponents. Now, we didn't spend all week on that. We stayed on our offensive strategy, but part of understanding our offensive strategy is understanding the defensive strategy. Are y'all with me? So let's look at the defensive strategy of our opponent, all right? Here it is. Number one, what is the first thing the devil wants to do? Well, he wants to blind the minds of the unbelievers. 2 Corinthians 4:4, Satan, who's the god of this world, has blinded the minds of those that don't believe. Do you guys remember what it was like before you were Christian? All the confusion, you might like, well, the blood, the cross, resurrection, that didn't make sense. I mean, are you serious? Really? Are you talking to somebody that's not a Christian? Like, and their minds are distracted, they're all over the place. I remember as a kid brought to church, and even as a young man, even in the beginning of college, before I was a Christian, it's like, this thing that doesn't make sense. I mean, I know there's a God up there somewhere. But my mind would get distracted. And you know how people's minds get distracted in church? Oh, what's going on? You know, how many likes on my Instagram? Oh, you know, okay, wait, oh, you know, who's playing? Okay, we gotta, and when are they gonna get all this traffic done? You know, and next thing you know, Pastor Jeff's preaching, and it is powerful, and the whole thing, and your just minds go all over the place. Well, the enemy wants to distract you. That's what he wants to do. Number one, he tries to blind the mind of the unbeliever. Tries to mess up our thought process. Number two, he wants to steal God's word from you. This is in the Bible. Listen, I'm giving you now the strategy of our opponent so that you can prevail in spiritual warfare. He tries to rob you of God's word. For example, how many different times in our lives you've heard something about God, you've read something, you get fired up, only to have the enthusiasm wane the next day. You're inspired by Pastor Jeff, you go out there, you get in the car, and you're like, and you just forget about it. You know, what was it? That was great. What are you talking about? I can't remember. That's why we got to hide the word in our heart. That's why we need to go over it and saturate our minds. The Bible says this, Matthew chapter 13. If the enemy can get, listen, you make a decision, Pastor Jeff, in January, we're going to read the Bible, we're going to pray, we're going to cry out to God. And just January 2020 is going to be a new year, 2020 vision. You get up, you know, like, I'm going to pray, I'm going to read my Bible, you know, you say, you get the Bible, you get there at 4:00 in the morning, you know, because somebody told you if you pray that early, the next thing you know, you wake up at 9:00. You fell asleep right there. Read your Bible, you know, the phones, everything, oh, email, oh, actually, you know, next thing you know, you know, but we have intentionality reading a car magazine more than the Bible. Why? Because the enemy wants to come steal that. That's what the Bible says. Look what he says. Look, Matthew, when anyone hears the word inspired by Pastor Jeff, and they don't really get it because they've not really gone deeper, They've not meditated on. That's why podcasts are important. You ought to listen to the messages two or three times, by the way. He says, well, the enemy just wants, the wicked one comes and tries to snatch the word that was sown in your heart. Wow. Just boom. Number one. So what does he want? He wants to blind the minds of the unbeliever. Keep sowing the seed to your neighbors. Keep sowing the seed to your kids. Keep sowing the seed to the lost people that you're working with or in the culture and community. Number two, he wants to steal that word that's sown. Number three, he wants to set traps to entrap you. We're talking about the strategies of our opponent. You know, it's interesting. My grandma just died a couple years ago, 99 years old. She was born in 1917, Cajun lady, my mom's mom. Just tough as nails, just Cajun. And she just, matter of fact, she was so tough, at 92, we had to tell her she could not cut her lawn anymore with an electric lawnmower. I'm serious, she'd cut her own lawn. Well, I can do it. She'd just run over the cord, get electrocuted, just keep going. I'm serious, I'm not joking. She'd go, oh, she'd just keep going. Just for years, you know, I'm like, Grandma, you can't do that. She'd get on the gutter, you know, thing, try to clean her gutters, you know, finally just like, she wouldn't go on a nursing, she's just tough. She was so tough. Matter of fact, she was as a kid, she was born in 1917 in Cutoff, Louisiana. I mean, French, no English, nothing. And before school, this is what she would do. She was a trapper. She would go and trap mink and muskrats in the bayous and the marshes of South Louisiana. That's what she did before school. So my mom, it's crazy, she gave my mom one of her traps. So she had a trap. My mom had this wall, all this stuff, you know, just like this trap, different things. It was kind of like, seriously, it looked like Cracker Barrel. And just, I mean, it's like, Mom, that's like Cracker Barrel. How many of y'all get nervous you go to Cracker Barrel? You know, you're sitting under a horse castrator eating a biscuit. It's like, you know, what is behind me? You know what I'm talking about? I'm just being honest. It's like, you know, feel violated. Well, my mom had like a little Cracker Barrel wall. And so there was this trap on the Cracker Barrel wall. And so my brother and I would get it down and we would like set it, and it's serious. You know, we put sticks in, it's like, you know, and he tried to set it one day for me to walk in. And thank God I saw it. I mean, seriously, snap your leg, you know, just there it is. Steve just stuck. And I began to think about the traps that people set for animals, but how the enemy tries to set traps for us. We have that temptation, and then we see there's a trap where the enemy wants us to fall prey to the trap that brings us back into the temptation, and then the sin pattern. I remember when I gave my heart to Christ, 19 years old, freshman in college, and man, my friends would call me, hey, come on, Steve, bro, let's go out, man. It's gonna be great, and I'm like, no, I'm not gonna do that. I serve God now. I serve God. Five times I just gave in to it. It's just traps. Did crazy stuff, dishonoring God. And finally, I had to realize, wait, time out. Here's when you really start winning. It's when you start becoming aware of the traps of the enemy. I said, time out. I say, everybody say trap. You see the trap. Okay, he's setting a trap for me. I'm not going down that trail. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 26, that you may come to your senses and escape the snare, the trap of the enemy. By the way, one of the number one traps, y'all want to know what one of the number one traps of the enemy is that we can all fall prey to? It's unforgiveness and bitterness. Oh man, you talk about the number one trap. You get disappointed in a relationship, watch your heart, guard your heart. It's a trap. Come on, are you with me? You want to squeeze out your spiritual life? It's a trap. The Bible says that we can escape the trap of the enemy. When we come into the trap, we actually get taken captive to do his will. Remember, the enemy has a plan for our life and God has a plan for our life. I know this talk's a little bit heavy for particularly new people. It's like, whoa, what is all this cosmic warfare that's going on? Man, this is like heavy. I thought this was about Jesus. It is about Jesus. It's about walking with Jesus effectively and victoriously. But this isn't heaven. Are y'all with me? This is not heaven. And by the way, there's a lot that's going on around us that we need to be aware of and effective. By the way, spiritual warfare is not just important for you to understand, but it's important for you to understand, not just for you, but also for others. How many other people in your life are falling prey to the traps of the enemy? Are you with me? I'll close with this scripture, Ephesians chapter 6. Now, here's what I'm going to do. I've got about 6 or 7 minutes. I'm going to read a portion of scripture. It's a little bit lengthy. I'm going to highlight some pieces. I'm going to have you out of here in 7 minutes. I'm only going to whet your appetite. Why? Because I want you guys to dig deeper into the concept of what Paul's talking about of how we can win in spiritual warfare. Here's what Paul said. I'm just continuing Ephesians 6. He says, therefore, take up the whole armor of God. We've got to participate in this. By the way, God doesn't put the armor on for us. You with me? You wouldn't walk out of the house in the morning unclothed. That would be weird. Well, why would we walk out of the house in the morning unclothed spiritually? Ill-equipped spiritually. Paul says, take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand. By the way, four times, watch the word stand here. Withstand in the evil day. And having done all to stand. Stand therefore, having girded your loins with truth. All right? This is important. Your waist with truth. Having put on the breastplate of righteousness. Having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. I'm talking about how we should be dressed in the battle that we're in. Paul's talk, above all, taking up the shield of faith with which you're able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. Put on the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints. In other words, Paul says we've got to be equipped. We've got to be spiritually dressed every day. Five defensive pieces, one offensive piece. Let me name them very quickly. Helmet of salvation. It's important that we're putting on, how do we do that? Memorizing scripture, putting the mind of Christ on each day. I'm not talking about getting saved each day. I'm talking about being equipped each day. Number two, the breastplate of righteousness. What is that? Our heart is guarded from the condemnation of the enemy. The devil reminds you of your past. No. I'm not who I was. I'm a new person in Christ. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, he who knew no sin, he made to be sin for us. That's Christ. In other words, here's how it works. God the Father put our sin on Jesus, and he put Jesus' righteousness on us. It's called the divine exchange. Our heart is guarded by the reality that when the enemy tries to condemn us of our past, listen, we are guarded by the righteousness of Christ. That's a piece of armor we've got to put on each day as we go out throughout the day. The breastplate of righteousness, another piece that Paul talks about is the shield of faith. Faith comes by what? Say it. Man, y'all got to be stronger than that. Faith comes by what? Say it. Romans 10, 17, Paul says, faith comes to you by hearing. In other words, and hearing by the word of God. When you hear the word of God, that's why it's important. Have your automobile, your car filled with preaching tapes and worship music. Have your home filled. Why? Because faith comes to you by what you hear. By the way, how does doubt come? By what you hear. By the opinions of men, by social commentators that are clueless and have no biblical worldview. I'm not going to let them put their spirit on me, full of unbelief and doubt, no biblical reference. I want to listen to what is godly, what is true, what is right, what is profitable, what's going to put faith on the inside of me. That's what Paul said. Paul says, you got a shield of faith. I want to lift that thing up, man. I'm not going to let that fear. No. Paul also says there's a belt of truth that we got to put on. Matter of fact, one of our pastors walked in one day. We had an executive team meeting. And I said, Pastor Dave, dude, that buckle is huge. You got a buckle. I'm not exaggerating. It was this big. I'm really not. I'm like, Dave, like, seriously, that thing is like overwhelming. I'm like, what is it for? He goes, no purpose. There's no purpose for that. He goes, matter of fact, that buckle is no purpose. I just like it. And honestly, my belt doesn't have a purpose. He goes, these jeans fit perfectly. You're wearing a buckle for show and a belt for show. Just want to make sure I get that. But how many of you know spiritually the belt of truth is not just for show? It actually holds up the whole thing. We base our life on something that is objective, that is truth, listen, that is verifiable. We stand upon a solid rock of the foundation of the word of God. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but God says, my word will not pass. How many are grateful your lives can be based upon that which does not shift? That which does not change. And by the way, listen, culture shifts every day. Listen, things that used to be bad are now good. Things that used to be good are now bad. They're switching to price tags every day. Clueless. They have no idea what's going on. Every day, everything changes. Just wait a year. Remember as kids, milk was good when you were like 6, but when you were 8, it wasn't? That's culture today. Ideologically, philosophically, why? Because they're basing everything on their emotions, cultural mores, and feelings, and not objective truth. Man, don't get me started preaching. All right, let me go on. Shoes of peace, gospel shoes of peace. We stand in the peace of God, the righteousness of God, the peace of God. One of the greatest testimonies to a dying and falling world is that our lives don't fall apart when our world does. That we can walk in the peace of God even when our environment's not peaceful. Let me give you this last thing. The last thing he says is that we've got to hold up each day. I'm talking about how to win victoriously in spiritual warfare. Watch this. Every day, the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. All right, let me ask you a question. Listen, what is the sword of the Spirit? Everybody say it out loud. The count of three. One, two, three. Say it. Well, not exactly. The Bible itself is not the sword of the Spirit. Guy came to me one time, he goes, Pastor, I was struggling last night. I just went and got my Bible. I just laid it on my chest. I said, that's good. I said, but the Bible's not Ben Gay. It doesn't draw out evil spirit. Just lay it on your chest. Are y'all with me? It's not just that. I mean, listen, you can have your Grandma Schofield Bible, 500 pounds on your coffee table. That's not the devil's. Not. It's the Bible getting in your heart, coming out of your mouth that becomes the sword of the Spirit. It is written. Everybody say, it is written. How did Jesus defeat the devil in the wilderness? He didn't think him away, he spoke him away. It is written. Man shall not live by bread alone. Come on, but by every word that comes out of the mouth of God. It's speaking the word. Speak the word. Speak the word. It's a sword of the Spirit. Cuts the lies of the enemy. Pushes back hell. Hell is nervous about a believer that speaks the word. I'll give you this last concept. We do not fight. Here it is. We do not fight for victory, but we fight from a position of victory. When Jesus Christ defeated the devil at the cross, look what Colossians says. Here's what he said. Having disarmed principalities, when Christ died on the cross, having disarmed principalities and powers, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it, what? The cross. When we fight, let me tell you what our fight is. We're enforcing the victory of Calvary. We're standing on the word of God. We're speaking who Christ has made us to be. We're speaking who God is. We're enforcing the victory of Calvary. The enemy's greatest strategy is, number one, to try to get you to think there's not a devil, or number two, to try to get you ill-equipped related to him. You have authority in Christ over the works of the enemy. And the moment you realize that as a Christian, wait a minute, I don't have to take this. I don't have to yield to this. I'm not going to succumb to this. I'm strong in God. In God. I'm strong in Christ. I know who I am in Christ. At the cross, Jesus defeated hell, death, and the grave. I can stand in the authority of what Jesus accomplished on the cross. Devil, take your hands off. Listen, take your hands off my mind. Take your hands off my children. Take your hands off my future. Take your hand. Listen, I resist you. Submit to God, James 4:6, James 4:7. Resist the devil and he will flee. Why? He flees from the Christian who knows who they are in Christ and that they can be victorious in the spiritual battle. Yeah. Father, I just thank you that you're teaching us as a people. You're teaching us the wonderful love of Jesus, yes, the foundation of our faith, but also that we are in a battle. And we do not have to succumb to the strategy of the enemy, but we can stand strong. We can stand strong, not based upon our strength, but as we put on your equipment, as we get dressed in the spiritual armor that you've called us to walk in, we can live victorious over the works of hell. Lord, I bless your people this day as they go forth in the name of Jesus. Amen. God bless you guys. You guys are amazing. Milestone Church.
Amen. Can we give Pastor Steve a hand? What an incredible word. I hope you receive that for your life. There's so much there. I'm going to ask the ushers to go ahead and make your way down. We're going to have a time of worship through giving. And so if you're a guest with us today, all we ask is that you drop that communication card in the offering as it's passed. Let that be your gift to us today. That's all we want from you today. Let's go ahead and stand up to our feet this morning. We're going to worship together here for just a moment as we give. Sing this out.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Come on, church, just lift it up.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Yes, you are, Jesus.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Yes, the waymaker.
come on down to the front. Maybe you're in a battle and you want to just pray with somebody together to see God move in that situation. Come down and pray with somebody before you head out. We got spiritual battles, but we also got a natural battle out there. It's called exiting our parking lot, okay? So here's the thing. There's a north and a south exit. If you go the south exit to Mount Gilead, it'll make it go smooth for you and for everybody else coming to the next service. And so I want to encourage you to do that. It's going to be faster for you if you go out the south exit. So not towards Roanoke, but towards back towards Keller. That'll be faster for you and everybody coming in. It'd be awesome if you could do that for us as you go. Thanks for being here. We'll see you back next week if we continue to live well.